Hey, Chad, you want to watch a movie?
Yeah.
How about...
No, not again.
Okay, what about...
I just saw that last week.
Okay, oh, I got it.
Wait. You want me to watch what?
So, what'd you think of The Thomas Crown Affair from 1999?
It was amazing. It captured so much of that first time I saw GoldenEye.
Yeah.
You know, that Pierce Brosnan, it captures so much of how I felt the first time I saw that I'm just like, I'm in. I am absolutely into this.
All right. Well, for those of you just joining us for the first time, welcome. This is You Want Me to Watch What? Where every couple of weeks, Chad and I recommend movies to each other that the other hasn't seen, and then we discuss it and try not to ruin our friendship.
So far, it's working.
So far, it's working, yes. This month, I chose the 1999 Thomas Crown Affair. It is a remake of the 1968 Thomas Crown Affair starring Steve McQueen.
Mm-hmm.
And there's just enough differences between the two, and we'll get into that later. But now, on with the show. Now, our feature presentation. So, the film starts, and we meet Thomas Crown. He is a very wealthy businessman in New York. Like, the businessman. You want him on your side in a business deal. And we see him going into the Metropolitan Museum of Art to look at his haystacks. There's a Van Gogh there that he likes, and he's sitting there. He opens his briefcase, pulls out a pastry. One of the museum custodians comes by and talks to him. And, you know, like, most people want that Monet over there for $100 million. He's like, I just like my haystacks. And he just sits there, and he leaves.
Mm-hmm.
He goes back to the office, and they make a big show of him forgetting his briefcase. Oh, I must have left it here last night. Later, he leaves, and he's carrying a briefcase. While all of this is going on, thieves have infiltrated the museum, Trojan horse style. The museum receives a shipment that's they receive a shipment that is supposed to be an Egyptian sarcophagus, but it is a Greek statue of a horse. They don't know what to do with it. Clearly, there's been a problem, so they put it in storage in the basement. Inside the horse are about three or four thieves. They cut their way out and bypass security, making their way into the fine arts section where that Monet happens to be. And they start, you know, they've dressed up as custodians. They're escorting people out. They're trying to rob the museum. They have a helicopter inbound. You know, they are trying to rob this place in broad daylight. Thomas comes back, wants to go back in to see his haystacks. And the fake custodians say, no, I'm sorry, we're closed for cleaning. He goes to the real custodians and say, they kicked me out. You know, very, very, you know, wealthy businessman. Like, they evicted me. What's going on here? The real custodians show up, realize there's something going on. Everything breaks down. The heist is over. Security measures have gone into place. Steel gates are coming down. It's pandemonium. Absolute pandemonium. And then... then... we see Thomas. He had set down a briefcase as the fake guard was telling him, hey, I'm sorry, we're closed. You know, you got to go. That briefcase has stopped one of the steel gates from closing all the way. He slips underneath it, pulls out his original briefcase, opens it up, takes the Monet off the wall, rips the frame off, puts it in the briefcase, specially designed briefcase, closes it up, slips back out under the gate, and leaves.
One of my first problems with the movie. Carry on.
Okay. So NYPD shows up to investigate, and so does Kathleen Catherine Banning. She is an insurance investigator who's there on behest of the owner of the $100 million Monet that was stolen. It's her job to find it. Mm-hmm. She's not working with the police. She can't arrest anybody. Her objective is get the painting back. End of story. So she's working with the police. They're trying to figure out what happened because these guys were just going to walk away. We're going to try to walk away with a room full of art. And yet somehow one got stolen and all these crooks got caught. What happened? Well, Thomas helped with the apprehension of one of these people by tripping them. He goes to the police station to give a statement. And Catherine kind of, something bugs her about him. Mm-hmm. Why is this guy involved? How is he involved? What's going on? So through some digging, she suspects him as the thief and starts to try and gain his trust to kind of infiltrate his little inner circle to get to know him better, maybe get something out of him. In the meantime, Thomas has donated a painting from his private collection to the museum to put in the Monet's place until it's returned, just so they have something there. There's a big to-do about that, blah, 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 blah. Catherine and Thomas kind of begin a cat-and-mouse, will-they-won't-they flirtatious kind of thing. She's still very convinced that he is the thief and agrees to go on a date with him. While they're on the date, she steals his keys, has a copy made, gets the keys back to him. The next day, unlawfully enters his house, finds the hidden compartment where the Monet is, takes it, goes back to police headquarters. Mm-hmm. Clearly, the mystery is solved.
Clearly.
No, it's a forgery because underneath the painting, they bring in an art expert, and underneath the painting is dogs playing poker. Somebody has painted an exact replica of the missing Monet on top of a dog's playing poker. So clearly this isn't the missing Monet. So she's back at square one. She knows Thomas did this. So there is a lot more back and forth between these two. And it is clear that feelings between the two of them are growing stronger on both sides. He takes her to Martinique. They have a wonderful time, and she's convinced that he's done it, and he's all but confessed to it. You know, he knows she knows, and she knows he knows she knows.
Mm-hmm. He almost relishes in,
yes,
in her knowing, because now she's just got to prove it, and he gets,
yeah,
to play the game of being one step ahead of the proof.
Yes. And at one point, he basically says, you know, we can leave tomorrow and just live our lives. Well, we'll be fugitives. Yes, but we'll be fugitives with means. That is not something to balk at. And she's all into it. She's calling people like, okay, if I leave tomorrow, what can I have? What can I take with me? She's all in on it. And she goes to his house to say, yeah, let's do this. And she finds him in his room packing suitcases with another woman. A woman that she's seen him with before, but there hasn't been, you know, she assumes it's kind of a flavor of the week kind of scenario. But he's packing bags. She's in his bedroom with him. They're discussing packing arrangements. Clearly, he's going to leave with her, not Catherine, and she's absolutely distraught. Thomas tells her, I'm going to put the painting back tomorrow. I will be at the museum at 4:00. I'm going to put the painting back, and then we can leave. You can either go with me, or you can alert the police. The choice is yours. And she leaves, and she's distraught because she's heartbroken. So she tells her contacts at the police, and they set up a big sting operation. And sure enough, at 4:00, Thomas Crown walks into the museum wearing a long gray overcoat, a brown briefcase, stands in the middle of the foyer, looks up directly into the cameras, spins around the room as if to say, I am here. Yes, it is me. And everybody on the security team is watching this. There's people in the lobby. There's people in the security, you know, in the security room looking at the camera feeds. He puts on a bowler hat and walks off. And what happens next is one of my favorite pieces of cinema. Because out of nowhere, you have all of these other people wearing the same coat, carrying the same briefcase, same bowler hat, dark hair, similar build. And they're walking in all directions. They've just like, it's like a flash mob, effectively. And these poor police officers cannot keep track of who is who. And at one point, he sets his briefcase down, picks up another one. Somebody picks that up. And it is the biggest version of the shell game that you have ever seen. You don't know where Thomas is, and you don't know where the briefcase is. During all of this, he slips away, takes off the hat and coat and whatever, pulls the fire alarm, and, you know, things go nuts. Sets off some smoke bombs in the already closed fine arts gallery, because they didn't want him to get back in there. Threw some smoke grenades in there, pulled the fire alarm, and chaos ensues. People are trying to leave. The sprinklers have come on, and these metal gates start to close to protect the paintings. And they close all the way except in front of the painting that he donated. As sprinklers kick on, the paint starts to wash away, revealing the Monet underneath. Come to find out, he had hired a forger to paint a painting over top of the Monet in watercolors. And it was back in the museum within 2 days of being stolen. The entire time they're trying to track him down.
Amazing, you know, misdirection. Just
exactly.
Beautiful.
Exactly. So they get back in the room and they're stunned by what they see, because there's the painting. How did he do it? The gates open up and another painting is missing. Earlier in the film, Thomas and Catherine go to the museum and they're talking very, you know, playfully. It's like, well, if I did it, you know, kind of thing. And he asks her, if you did it, which painting would you take? And she points to one, and that is the one that is missing. So Catherine is just, she's amazed by what's going on. She runs to the rendezvous point and he's not there. There's a courier there who hands her a large portfolio and says he wanted you to have this, and walks off. And inside is the painting, the new stolen painting, the one that she had picked out. And he's not there. He's gone. He's vanished. She's heartbroken again. Well, the painting that she was hired to find has been returned, so she's going to go back home to England. She gives the portfolio to somebody at the airport with a note to say, hey, take this to Detective so-and-so at NYPD. He'll know what to do with it. Here's some cash to cover it. She gets on the plane, and she starts crying. And from behind her, this handkerchief comes out of nowhere, and it's Thomas. And she jumps over the seat. You think she's going to strangle him, but then they start kissing, and credits.
Then credits.
So, I saw this movie back in, you know, 99, 2000, something like that. And what I've always loved about the movie is that end scene in the museum with the flash mob style, you know, misdirection, and a brilliant use of Nina Simone's Sinner Man.
The soundtrack is so good.
I know. The whole soundtrack is amazing.
Soundtrack is so good.
And just, there's very little about this movie that I look at and go, okay, you know. There's a little bit between Rene Russo and Pierce Brosnan that doesn't quite gel, but at the same time, in other parts, it really does. So it's, you know, it's a forgivable kind of thing. Dennis Leary is his least Dennis Leary-y.
Yeah. Yeah, that tracks. He's
he's the NYPD detective who has teamed up with Catherine. All he wants to do is, you know, he doesn't care about some rich guy stealing a painting because the day before he stopped a dad from beating his son to death, and 2 days before he stopped, you know, a mugging and stuff like that. He's got other things he wants to be doing with his job.
It, as he put it, I don't care what happens to swirls of paint that only affects rich people.
Yes, exactly.
Who care about swirls of paint.
Yes. So, I mean, it was nice to see him less angry.
Mm-hmm.
Still very cynical, but not screaming at, you know, the camera. But since I saw it, this has been one of my favorite... I won't go that far. But it's been one of the top movies that I've enjoyed, and that scene in particular at the end of the museum is one of my favorites in all the films I've seen.
Mm-hmm.
So tell me your thoughts on it, my friend.
So I had three things that at the very beginning of the movie I was just like, huh, is this going to follow through? And I'm just – because I'd just gotten done watching my random movie for last month's podcast.
The other show, yeah.
And so I was like, okay. So I was just in that mindset as I'm looking critically. I'm not watching to enjoy. I'm just, you know.
Yes.
And so early on, when he first gets to the museum. So this is all first 10 minutes, right?
Yeah.
And he almost gets hit by the garbage truck.
Yeah.
There's very clearly a vehicle like 10 feet in front of that garbage truck. And the garbage truck like slams on its brakes like it just realized it might hit a person. Where it was going to hit that car. And though he passes, and the thing takes off as though there's no car there. It's like, that irritates me. The second piece is everyone talks about how hot it is because that opening thing, they crush the AC to make it hot.
Yeah, yes.
But everyone outside in New York is wearing overcoats.
Okay,
it's like,
yeah.
You know, I don't care. Whenever this is set, I don't care. You don't wear overcoats in the summer. Not unless everyone is packing, you know, violin cases. You know, it just doesn't happen. And the third one is he broke the painting stretcher when he folded up the briefcase when he stole the Monet.
Uh-huh.
You can see it. It's like it has to break. There's no way it doesn't break. And then he takes it out and it's perfectly
and
it's fine. It's just like...
Yeah.
I hate this. And then the movie actually kicks in. It's like, okay, no, I'm on board. I'm fine. All the other little nitpicks, you know, where Rene Russo's character, like she gets the Pepsi out of the thing to have like her rant of it's Thomas Crown that did this. And it's like obvious that can is empty from the moment she opens it. Is like her very first drink is to like hold that thing up like she was a rapper in the 90s.
Yeah.
It's like, but again, they're nitpick things that came from the other podcast.
Fair.
Story-wise, it's not reinventing a wheel. It's barely reinventing the 1968 movie. It's just instead of a bank robbery, now it's an art robbery.
Exactly. And have you seen the original?
I have.
Okay, I haven't. But I did some reading up on it. And basically, they rewrote it because they wanted people to feel, to like Thomas Crown more. And they thought that if he did an armed bank robbery, they wouldn't. But an art heist, clearly. Well, and nobody's getting hurt.
Well, and they're right. Because the whole thing comes off as innocent, almost.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's doing this thing, nobody's getting hurt, and then the painting's, at the end, it's revealed, and the painting's put back within 2 days.
Mm-hmm.
Literally, nobody is out anything other than a little bit of stress.
Yeah.
So, and that part works. Dennis Leary, you're right. He was so good at that role. You know, he nailed that role without being all Dennis Leary-y. I appreciated, and this is just me, right? I appreciated Faye Dunaway as the psychiatrist for two reasons. One.
Yes.
Because the psychiatrist is the only one who speaks the truth to Thomas Crown throughout the whole movie.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Second is Faye Dunaway is who played the insurance investigator, the special investigator in the original movie.
I did know that,
she was the love interest there.
It was a nice little Easter egg.
Kind of like the soundtrack. They reused bits of the soundtrack from the old movie. The Windmills of Your Mind as part of the ballroom scene.
Yeah.
So it is a wonderful, innocent heist movie. This is the...
Yeah.
You know, in terms of... In terms of things like, you know, danger and scary bits and nudity and so forth, it's pretty low key. Although I will say that the sex scene on the stairs looked remarkably uncomfortable. Like there's no way that they're not coming off of that looking like they got bruises on their back, like somebody tried, like Jacob's ladder trying to get to heaven.
My spouse was watching that with me, and she's like, on the stairs? And I said, yeah, they're not carpeted. Those are marble stairs. Oh, my God!
She's right.
She's right, exactly.
And again, soundtrack, amazing. Music's by Bill Conti, which he was the guy who did the music for the original Rocky soundtrack.
Okay, yeah.
And it has that kind of jazzy, you know, urban kind of urban, like East Coast. It has that East Coast kind of jazzy sound to it that I really, really liked. Yeah. And I like the ending of this one better. The ending of this one is better than the original.
Okay.
In the old one, the two don't get together.
Oh, okay.
So at the ending of the other one, and I'll just spoil it because I'm not going to have you watch it. If you want to watch it, you can.
That's fine.
It's the money's going to get stolen, and here's where the drop is. And so the drop gets made, and then Thomas Crown's car shows up, and it's a Rolls Royce kind of thing. And Vicky, because that's the character in that one,
yeah.
Vicky goes up and is handed basically a card that says, here's the money, feel free to take it and get in. If not, the car is yours. And then Thomas Crown flies, you know, he's in the plane flying overhead to get where he's going. Very stylish, very 1960s.
Yeah, I would bet, yeah.
But I like the two of them kind of getting back together because they were both a challenge to the other.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, their characters played well off of each other.
Like, long-term success of this relationship is practically nothing. But it works in the moment.
Yes, in the moment.
So, and of course, you know, John McTiernan continues to be a delight as a director. You know, the cars are wonderful. You know,
yep.
I have no notes outside of a couple of those things. It's just like, watch your continuity. You know, be aware of those things.
And this is one of those, and maybe it was me because I brought it, but I didn't notice the overcoats. I just didn't notice it. And it didn't occur to me that the truck had slammed on its brakes. There was like another car 10 feet ahead of it. And then it took off. Like, to me, that set up that Thomas is very kind of self-centered. It's like, he's just going to walk right down the middle of traffic.
Oh.
And nothing is going to hit it. That's to me, that's all that scene was. I didn't think about that there's only this much room between.
You're right.
Yeah.
You know, it. You're right. That's what the scene was meant to do. And if I hadn't just finished watching, you know, The Outsiders, The Outsider, I would not have been in the mode of like, all right, let's see how this one messes up.
Notes on how to hate Justin later.
No, I don't hate it. This is a good move. This is a see it from me.
I'm so glad to hear that. It is absolutely a see it from me as well. It is mid to late 90s Pierce Brosnan. So it's during his Bond phase. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, you've got all the Bond movies. You've got this. You've got him and Robinson Crusoe, which was a good version of it. And, you know, kind of... And Dante's Peak, that was another mid-90s Pierce Brosnan movie. So all of those just kind of coalesce into this one version of Pierce Brosnan that just kind of sticks in my mind. Post-Remington Steele, during Bond era, is kind of him to me. So this just fits perfectly. So yeah, it's to see it.
Mm-hmm.
Perfect. I believe it's your turn.
I got an idea.
Hello, meet Popsicles. Why don't you grab your multipass, a drink, and come sit with us?
Let's pick each other's brain. We want you to be part of our intimate conversation about science fiction topics.
Let's do this. Join us, and let's talk about science fiction topics in books, movies, TV shows, and games.
At Science Fiction Remnant, you are invited to listen in.
Listen now on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Audible, or wherever you listen to podcasts.
And don't forget your multipass.